What's up everybody, this is Mark from MJ Aquascaping, partnering again with BRSFresh to bring you another video about CO2. We've already talked about the basics of CO2 and I showed you how to properly set up a CO2 system. But in today's video, I want to make sure that you use your CO2 system in the best possible way. So I wrote down 10 mistakes that I made in the past, and hopefully with this video I can help you avoid making these mistakes as well. Okay, so let's get straight to it. The first mistake that I made was not putting my CO2 on a timer. So when I started using CO2, I was just using it 24/7. And not only is this very wasteful, it's also a little bit dangerous because at night the plants are not using CO2, so the levels will just build up. And they can build up to a point where it's actually dangerous for your fish. And of course, we want to make sure we avoid that. Now, luckily these days, the good quality CO2 regulators just have an electronic valve built in, so you can just connect it to power and then put it on a timer. I actually like to use these smart sockets, so I'll just connect the CO2 to this and then make a schedule for like 8 or 9 hours per day. Then mistake number two, this is one that I still see happen quite often. Mistake number two is turning on the CO2 at the exact same time as the light. So ideally, as soon as the light turns on, you already want to have a good amount of CO2 available for the plants, so they can immediately start photosynthesizing and start growing. So if you turn on the CO2 at the exact same time as the lights, of course it takes a little while for those CO2 levels to build up. So ideally, you want to start earlier. So if you take a look at my small tanks behind me, and the light turns on at 1 p.m., but the CO2 turns on at 12 p.m., so like an hour earlier. For the big tank, same thing, light turns on at 1 p.m., but the CO2 turns on at 11 a.m., so like actually 2 hours earlier. And that's something that you just keep in mind. Start the CO2 before the lights. Then mistake number three, this is one that I wish I knew a lot sooner, would have saved me a lot of headache. Mistake number three is not using a CO2 check valve or not using a check valve close enough to the diffuser. So I have a little check valve here, and basically this thing just allows the CO2 gas to only flow in one direction. So if I blow on this end, I can blow through it. If I switch it around, nothing happens. So what this does is it prevents water from flowing back into the system. Okay, so here we have an example. Here's a CO2 system. We have a diffuser, some tubing, I have a bubble counter, and just behind the bubble counter, there's a check valve. Now this system has been off for more than 12 hours. And inside the diffuser and the tubing up until here, there's water. Because the CO2 system was off, the CO2 gas stopped flowing. So the water actually went back into the system. Now, because I have a check valve here, the water stopped here. If I wouldn't have this check valve, it would go all the way throughout, through the entire tubing, all the way down to the regulator. Usually there's a check valve inside the regulator as well, so you don't have to worry too much about that. The thing is though, that if I would turn on the CO2 system again, all the water that has built up has to go back through the diffuser into the tank before we can get the CO2 gas out, And that can take a long time. So just something that you want to avoid. So in the past, I would not have this check valve and my entire CO2 tubing was full of water. And then it would sometimes take an hour or even 2 hours before all the water had traveled back through the diffuser into the tank, and then I would finally get some CO2 gas. So yeah, that's just something you want to avoid. So always use a check valve as close to the CO2 diffuser as possible. Okay, mistake number four is using a bad quality CO2 diffuser. And honestly guys, a good quality CO2 diffuser makes a massive difference. If you look at my tanks, every single diffuser that I'm using has this brown membrane disc. And that's producing very fine bubbles, almost like a mist, And that's exactly what we want, because these really tiny bubbles easily dissolve into the water column. And the easier it is for them to dissolve, the easier it is to increase the CO2 levels. But if you have a bad quality CO2 diffuser, then those CO2 bubbles are just a lot bigger. They will travel to the water surface a lot faster, and they just don't have time to dissolve, So get yourself a good quality CO2 diffuser. Okay, then let's talk about mistake number five. So a question that I get asked a lot is, hey MJ, how many bubbles of CO2 are you using per second on this and this tank? So mistake number five is using bubbles per second as a way to measure CO2. So let's say, for example, on this big tank over here, I'm using 5 bubbles per second. So then you think, okay, I have the same size tank, so I'm also going to use 5 bubbles per second. But that doesn't work because there are so many more variables. So for example, just to name one, On this tank I'm using RO water, and CO2 dissolves faster in soft water. So if you are using tap water and your tap water is really hard, you're going to need way more CO2 just to get to the same level, you know? So bubbles per second as a way to measure CO2 is a bit of a mistake. So then let's go straight to number six. Mistake number six is not using a CO2 drop checker. And in my opinion, a CO2 drop checker is just a way easier and more accurate way of measuring CO2. It's way more accurate than using bubbles per second. So a drop checker is just a glass vessel that we fill with a special pH solution. And the color of that solution will change depending on your CO2 levels. So if you don't have enough CO2, it's blue. And if you have enough CO2, it's green. If you have too much CO2, it's yellow. So it's just very easy to check your CO2 levels. You can't really make any mistake there, you know? Mistake number seven is not having a spare CO2 cylinder. So if you're using a professional CO2 kit with a pressurized cylinder, regulator and everything, it's always good to have a second or a spare cylinder. Because the moment your CO2 runs out, it's always kind of on a bad time, you know, like either it's on the weekend or you're just very busy, you don't have time to get a refill. And the moment your tank sits without CO2 for 1 or 2 days, you're gonna get algae. So yeah, get yourself a spare CO2 cylinder. Okay, mistake number eight is having your CO2 diffuser in the wrong spot in your tank. So let's talk about what is the right spot. So if you look at my tanks, the CO2 diffuser is always on the opposite end of the filter outflow. And in my opinion, this is the best spot for a diffuser. Because even if you have a good quality CO2 diffuser that's producing this small CO2 mist, the CO2 bubbles still have a tendency to go straight to the servers. And then we lose them and they don't really do much. So we want to keep those CO2 bubbles inside the water column for as long as possible, just so they have more time to dissolve, you know? So if the filter outflow is pushing those CO2 bubbles down, they will stay in the water column for longer. It just gives us a better end result, I guess. And too often I see people putting their CO2 diffuser in a spot where there's just not really any flow and those CO2 bubbles are just going straight to the surface and they don't really increase the CO2 levels too much. Mistake number nine is not cleaning your CO2 diffuser on a regular basis. So when CO2 diffusers get dirty, they just become less efficient. It's just as simple as that. Again, CO2 bubbles will get bigger, they will travel to the surface faster, and then you just lose them. So every month or so, I like to dip my diffusers in a little bleach solution. Just hot water with some bleach. I like to soak them in there for 10-15 minutes and actually leave the whole CO2 system running, just so it kind of cleans itself in that bleach solution and I don't get any bleach solution inside the diffuser, if that makes sense. So I just leave the CO2 running, take the diffuser out of the tank, put them in a little cup with some water and bleach. And then after 10 to 15 minutes, I put them in a different cup with some dechlorinator and that's it. Then the last one, mistake number 10 is using water in your bubble counters. And I'm specifically talking about the bubble counters on top of the CO2 regulator. If you put water in that, usually after a month or so, the water has evaporated and you can't really count the bubbles per second anymore. It's a little bit annoying, you constantly have to refill it. So lately I've started using glycerin, and glycerin is just a thicker solution that doesn't evaporate. It's 100% safe to use as well. And if you use this in your bubble counters, you never have to worry about evaporation. You never have to refill them anymore. Quite useful, very cheap as well. So that was the last one. So let me know in the comments if you've been making some of these mistakes. Hope this video was helpful. As always, thanks for watching. See you guys in the next one.